Good afternoon and welcome. I'm sorry we're not in the House of Commons.
The House of Commons is too small.
I'm delighted to chair today's events, particularly since those of you that don't know me, I am a Syriophile who has spent many years travelling back and forth to Syria and Lebanon. Spent earlier this year a week at a refugee camp, Nizip, on the Turkish-Syrian border, and spent probably 5 years of my life in discussions with Bashar Assad, trying to bring him over from the dark side. Clearly I failed at that. And then subsequently spent a lot of time getting to know the rebel groups on the ground until August last year, when we came back for that vote in the House of Commons, which unfortunately went the wrong way, with the result that we've seen, particularly the rise of ISIS and the continued fragmentation of Syria, which I suspect we will never see recover, at least in a long, long time. But anyway, I would like to welcome Susan Dabbous, who is, I guess, is he half Italian, half Syrian?
Yes, exactly.
Half Italian, half Syrian journalist, who in April 2013, while in Syria, was abducted and held hostage with three other Italian journalists for 11 days before being released. In March 2014, a chronicle of her abduction was published, and it's available in English under the title, How Would You Like to Die? Diary of a Kidnapping in Syria. Susan works for a variety of Italian publications, in particular the Italian channel Sky News 24 and the daily newspaper Avvenire. She has followed the events in Syria closely since March 2011, when she's been based in Beirut, my favorite city in the Middle East. Okay, over to you, Susan.
Thank you for the introduction. I will start from telling the story of the kidnapping, but also giving a picture of Syria at that time and my work in Syria in the last 3 years. First of all, I'm not a war journalist, and this is very important to me to specify, because I feel more honest to say that I started covering Syria just because of my personal affection and interest in that country, that is my father's country. I grew up in Italy, and my knowledge of Syria before the war was personal, and I went there to meet my family, to spend holidays, but not to cover stories because I was focused on other journalism things. So I was covering, I started covering the Middle East just starting from the Arab Springs. And when I entered Syria in 2011, 2012, I was completely aware of the risks. So I'm not saying that not being a war journalist made me a naive journalist at all. So I was entering with with the knowledge of the territory, but of course it wasn't that dangerous like now. So of course I need to specify this, because I still receive messages and email from journalists, from freelancers who want to enter Syria, and now it's too dangerous. It's just impossible to do our job. But in 2013, it was April, was my last time entering illegally Syria from the Turkish border. The situation started to, it was very bad, but not bad like now. So I entered Syria with this TV team, and I have been working as a freelancer, mostly as a print journalist. So it was the first time that I was entering with a big crew, and I was very concerned because I knew that we were more noticeable. And when I was entering Syria on my own as a woman, knowing how to cover myself properly, and I was not noticeable at all. So when we entered, it was the 3rd of April 2013, and the first 24 hours were quite smooth, because we crossed the border illegally at night, and at that time was quite easy. I don't think that now is that easy, because maybe Turkey is patrolling more the borders after what happened. And so when we entered, we wanted to cover stories from the civil society, because the journalist, the right journalist with I was, he covered the front line from Aleppo a few months ago, and he said, I want to tell your stories, the story that you used to write for print press, and now with cameras we can show how refugees live in Syria, inside Syria. So we went there, and I knew that in this Christian village called Gassaniye, there were refugees, but also a sort of a cohabitation, coexistence mm-hmm. between Muslim and Christians. And it was interesting for us as an Italian TV to show this. And we went there, but we found the village completely empty, abandoned, and bombarded. So we found the priest was there, and we tried to interview Father François Mourad, and he absolutely refused to talk, to speak with us, because he said, why have I to give you an interview if media and governments know exactly what is happening here and nothing changed? Because he spoke to media before and anything changed. So he said, I will not give you an interview, but if you really want to know what is happening here, I'll show you the church. And when he said that, I felt something wrong, because I said, first of all, I didn't feel safe in that village, because I saw that something wrong was happened, and the environment was particularly scary. It was like a ghost place with nobody, and the priest was there with a couple of old people. But the journalist, I mean the leader of the team, wanted to go there because he wanted to film. This is normal. I mean, we are journalists, understood. But as a Syrian, I felt that I was in the wrong place. So we went to the church, and we found signs of recent desecration. And when we were filming, after 10 minutes, we found a group of jihadists out of the church. So I didn't have, when I asked the priest, who made this desecration? He just pointed out of the door, and I found a group of Jabhat al-Nusra. I was terrified, but I mean, my feeling was like I was living a nightmare or a movie, but I tried to protect myself rationally, not doing anything. Actually, I was very passive. So the different stages of the kidnapping, where first of all the arrest, so we have been arrested there, stopped, they checked our footage and images, and then after 2 hours of this checking, they said, you have to come with us because we have to clear all the footage, all the images, and then we will let you go. I have to say that our fixer, and in this case the fixer is the local, the guide who helped perhaps the journalist, was not a young activist. It was an important and well-known businessman, Syrian businessman, and this helped a lot. But even though he was kidnapped with us at the beginning, so the first days he was with us, and So we were with him. He tried to explain that we were not spies. We were just filming. We were Italian, and they saw that I was Syrian, so they were suspicious. So they started the interrogation when we were moved from the church to their base. And as a woman, I thought that the best thing to do at that point was to separate from my colleagues, to show that I knew their ideology, I knew what I had to do. And when they said to get out of the van, and we had it was a big car, I said, I don't want to go with them. I will stay here in the van, and in order to be covered and not to be seen and by the jihadists and the fighters. So I spent 4 hours in the van at the beginning, thinking that that was not a normal check, that was a kidnapping. And after 4 hours, I've been moved to a room inside their base that was an abandoned building. And I was there on my own for 2 hours before the sheikh, the leader of this group, arrived, and he started saying, do you work for the CIA or for the Italian Secret Service? And I said, I'm not a spy, I'm just a journalist. And he started checking my passport, and of course he saw that I was born in Syria and I have a Sunni family name. So that reveals that I'm Muslim. But of course he asked why I didn't speak a good Arabic, because my Arabic was elementary, I mean, it was basic. And I said that I grew up in Italy. So when I said that I had an Italian mother, he asked, is your mom Catholic Christian? And I decided not to lie, because I thought that lying was too dangerous, because they could find out the truth. So I said the truth, and I said that my mom was not converted, and I knew exactly what extremists think about moderate Muslims who are the first enemy. So I was in a very delicate position. I knew that they had already interrogated my other colleagues, and we all had the same version. But what they said to me, their opinion about our presence there was that, actually, it's a bit funny now to think, the priest called the Vatican. The Vatican called the Italian TV, and the Italian TV, the RAI, sent us there to show the desecration. So I said that we didn't have any relationship with the priest at all before, and sadly we found out 2 months after we had been released that Father Francois Murad was killed by them. So this was the beginning, and I can say that the first 12-24 hours were the most terrible, the worst. And after that I got used to be in the prison, even if it was a terrible place to be. Thank God I've not been touched. I've been physically respected. The problem was that I felt that I was in a completely unsafe environment, because this prison was an abandoned house and without doors, so I could hear people tortured in other rooms. So even if I don't, that as a woman I was not going through this, in this case you never know. So I was doubting and wondering if at some point it would have arrived my turn. And I wanted to go away from that prison, and I said, I want to learn how to pray. I'm Muslim, I'm original Muslim, I'm secular, but I want to learn. And I showed that I had a notebook with me in which I was writing my Arabic exercise as a beginner. So somehow maybe he, I mean, the leader, the sheikh trusted me, or he wanted to move me away, even if I wouldn't ask to go far from, I mean, to go in a different environment from that prison. He brought me to a woman, and this made the difference of my captivity, because I spent 4 days in an apartment with a young girl jihadist, and I felt more safe, even if physically that apartment was more exposed to bombardment, so we were under shelling. But I could wash and eat properly and sleep in a clean place. What was interesting of those 4 days, is the, let's say, the female jihadism. So I discovered this other side of the martyrdom culture that is made mostly by the family side, the family part of the jihadi life. So those group of jihadists were, it was composed by very young fighters, mostly from Northern Africa. So in my case, I was with this Tunisian girl. She was 22 years old. And she introduced me to their Islam, but I called that a superstitious version of Islam that is very far from the real Islam or the traditional Islam that I knew from my Syrian family. And she treated me well, so she was not violent, but she was psychologically violent, because I was all the time under control. And this means that I had to mind how to eat, how to pray, how to speak, and I had to follow all the rituals, the rituality she was teaching me. But I had also normal conversations with her, woman to woman. So we spoke about her wedding, and she showed me the picture of her wedding, and it was a normal Arab wedding. It wasn't different compared to other pictures I saw of Arab friends getting married with big colorful colored dresses or makeup, so dancing, music. So I found this in contrast with the jihadist culture, because they are against the music, they are against the static room things. So I was surprised. But this made Miriam, this is her name, more human to me. And this was important to me to understand that they could be absolutely normal guys, normal people that I have met in my interviews, for example, because I was interviewing Salafists in Lebanon or in other places, and there is a very small line between being violent or being just extremists. So I try to understand why they became violent, why they agreed to this ideology. And I asked Miriam, why did you come to Syria? Because she asked me, why are you with those journalists who are not your family? Because you are a woman and you shouldn't travel anymore. And I said, I was working. Now that I'm converted and I know that I was wrong, and I was playing this part. I was pretending to be sorry, to be an independent woman working. But I asked her, why are you in Syria? You are Tunisian, I'm Syrian. Why are you in Syria? She said, I was in Tunisia. She was studying, actually. She was studying first year of university. And I felt very sorry for what was happening in Syria. All these Muslim brothers killed by the Bashar al-Assad regime. And when I got married with my husband decided to go and fight in Syria. I wanted to follow him, to go with him, because I mean, this is my part of jihad, is being with him during the fighting. Mm-hmm. She was cooking for the brigade. She was taking care of him, and actually they were, while he was not fighting, they were having a normal family life, or let's say just married life. So they were planning to have a family, and she also said that they were having a normal sexual life, and she wanted to go also in details, because she was teaching me how was the right way to have sex in a married life in their culture, in the extremism. So the formula I have to say to have a holy sex for reproduction. And also I saw that she was getting ready for delivery, for pregnancy, through videos, because they had no idea of, I mean, they didn't have doctors and they didn't have hospitals, so actually she was getting ready to give birth through a YouTube video. It was given to her by her husband, and it was with the other videos she had, videos of, about Islam, or Bin Laden speeches, or other religious content. So, I mean, the meeting, the 4 days with Miriam were very important to me, to understand also this other part of the jihadist culture that we don't know properly. So now there are other witnesses we know through women, two girls who came back from Syria, who were introduced by the Salafist women in the Islamic State, obliged to or have a sort of a holy prostitution, like the temporary marriage with marriages with the fighters, or sometimes they fight, but usually they don't. So in my case, I met Miriam, and she was not fighting, she was just supporting the group. I want to say something about the culture of martyrdom, because the title of the book, How Would You Like to Die, actually is a question she made me. She asked, Susan, what's your favorite way to die? And I was really surprised. Maybe not threatening, but surprised, because I said, what kind of question is it? It's like when we ask, what's your favorite dishes, or what's your favorite color? And I said, I was sincere, I said, I don't know, I never thought. I mean, we in the West, we have the culture of life, so to die, death is a bad thing. You don't think about what's your favorite way to die. And she answered, I would like to die or praying or reading the Quran. So they are the holiest way to die, and I discovered this. And then, I mean, this shocking question was the introduction of the one of the best parts, I mean, my favorite part of the book, which is the dialogue with Miriam about the jihad and about exactly the life and death. And I said, how can you live here thinking of the risks your husband is taking fighting? And I asked if she was afraid of being abandoned by her husband, or just to be alone because he would die. And she said, "Of course, I'm scared, but in the same time, I know that we are doing the right thing. We are liberating a country from a dictatorship." And we are doing the right thing. So if we die here, we will go to paradise. And then there is always this paradise and evil. And this country, I mean, their life is black or white. And there is nothing in the middle. So I was a bit fascinated, I have to admit, by her culture, because at some point I thought, I'm so sad, and maybe I'm going to die in the country where I was born, and my life now seems, I mean, it's misery, and I'm in the front of a happy woman. So she was happy, and this happiness comes from this completely crazy ideology of doing the right thing in the right moment, and if the guy didn't care, they're happy. So in this culture, they're never scared of anything. And I thought that actually, even if we can try to fight them with drones, with military attack, they are the winners, because they are meant, I mean, their ideology is made in a very simplistic way. It's very simple, and they don't have any complications. So I found this particularly interesting, because sometimes I was able to think as a journalist, not just as a hostage. And I said, they have the opportunity in their 20s here in Syria or Iraq to do something in their lives, something that they wouldn't have done in their terrible suburb of a remote country or city. So their lives were useless before. They felt useless, and in Syria at that moment they had the adrenaline, they had the dream of building their state. So for a few days I tried to understand their culture, even if I was in a terrible position.
Great. Thank you very much for that. I think that's an excellent introduction to hopefully some good questions. I know I've got lots, but I will hold back. So does anybody have any questions for Susan? Yeah?
Well, to start with the obvious question, I suppose, Susan, how did it come to pass that you escaped? Mm. Or rather didn't escape, but were let out?
And yes.
And I think I know the answer, but I'll be curious to hear it, and I'll have a follow-up on.
Yeah. So we had the fixer who worked as a mediator with the Italian government. So he was kidnapped with us during the first 2 days, then he was released. When he was released, instead of disappearing as most of the fixers do in these cases, he was put in contact with the Italian government through a friend of mine who is a journalist as well. And he started the negotiation and was finally they found an agreement, because maybe they didn't want to kidnap us for a long time because we were in their bases. We were not in the front line, so we were maybe a problem to them. Also because they were going to move to Raqqa, because at that point the Islamic State started.
To be precise, they paid a ransom to come out, yes.
Okay, so the official version is that they didn't pay ransom. And they wanted, actually, this is the version they wanted. I mean, the kidnappers wanted to specify. They said, we didn't want a ransom. When we are going to release you, when they decided to release us, they said, we are going to release you. Don't say to journalists that we wanted a ransom because we are honorable. But then the mediator said that they wanted lots of goods. And in this case, I think there were cars, maybe weapons, I don't know, and other military equipment they need for the winter.
So my final point on this end is, from your knowledge of this group, or I suppose you may look at this group, how important then, when it comes to kidnapping, this scourge that we've seen across the region, how important is the economic argument for it from their perspective versus the ideological argument?
I think economical arguments are always good. So even if they wanted to say that they didn't kidnap us for money, it was just for security reasons. But money is always important, because even if they had money, and at that point Jabhat al-Nusra was the most rich group in fighting in Syria, rich because they received lots of money from sponsors. Money is never enough. Everything is expensive in a war zone. Everything. Food, gas, oil, everything. So I think that ransoms are always valuable. Sometimes they can have stronger political reasons, or like in the case of American hostages, in which maybe money is not that important because of political reasons. I mean, it's symbolically important to them to say, we have the enemy, we can blackmail the American government, we can protect us from drones, which is not true.
Yes?
I may have missed it, but I'm not quite clear who did kidnap you. Was it a main group or a fringe group or just individuals?
So at that point, Jabhat al-Nusra was the strongest group fighting in Syria, and it was an al-Qaeda branch of the Iraqi group of al-Qaeda. So Jabhat al-Nusra was founded by al-Baghdadi, but was run by Julani in Syria. So our group was affiliated to Jabhat al-Nusra. But in those days, we were unlucky enough to see how the Islamic State was born, because the 9th of April, they announced that they were not Jabhat al-Nusra anymore, they were Islamic State of Iraq and Sham.
Yes.
How was your college treatment?
Okay, they have been physically respected, but as a woman I had more food, more blankets, more possibility to wash, and they didn't. So they had less food, they shared the same room, but they have not been tortured or touched at all. They tried to convert them, but not. They didn't insist. Maybe also because we spent in total only 11 days. But compared to other stories, I can say that they have been treated well.
Why did you feel uneasy about going to see the church?
Because I felt tension in the priest house. Tension was a mix of bad feelings and feeling inappropriate there, because I was having a terrible a terrible, uncomfortable feeling, a contrast between being a journalist and a Syrian. So as a Syrian, I felt uncomfortable because I was in someone else's house that didn't want us. So as a journalist, I mean, why do you have to put your job first and then the terrible human condition of people living in misery in a war zone, eating bread and onions, just because you need to go back home with a piece, with the job done? I'm not blaming journalists because I'm a journalist, but sometimes our job is humanly terrible.
Yes.
You said that most or all of the group you were with were foreign, were non-Syrian, North Africa or whatever. Did you get any impression about what kind of relationship, if any, they had with the local Syrian population? And if I might just add a related question, did they talk at all about having a vision specifically for Syria, for the future of Syria, or were they all for just, you know, the kind of thing you had?
Yeah, thank you for the question. Jabhat al-Nusra was a very popular group in Syria within the opposition fighters. Even secular fighters were accepting their help because they were the more effective and efficient in fighting. So they were, I can say they were popular. In the case of Ghassaniyeh, the village, the Christian village, I couldn't know because and the population just left, so I couldn't see if they had. Of course, I mean, I saw how did they trade the priest, and they were pretending to say that they respected the Christians, and of course they didn't. The vision of Syria was shown by the Sheikh at the end of the captivity when he released us. He was in a sort of friendly chat after he treated me with death. The day after was chatting friendly with me, saying, I think that this war is going to be long, because our goal is not just to topple the Assad regime, it's to control the country and to build to start an Islamic state in which after the Syrian regime, the Assad regime, they would have started to fight the secular Syrians. So they predict that the war would last at least another 5 years.
Yep. You mentioned that when you were younger, you went to Syria to visit family. Are your family still in Syria, and did your capture have any impact on them?
No, thank God, didn't have any impact to my family. My family is originally from Aleppo, and they moved to Damascus, which is now safe because the regime took over the control. So at the moment they're still in Syria. I'm talking about relatives and my grandmother. And the situation is, let's say, not too bad compared to two years ago. But life is particularly impossible because of prices. Everything became very expensive. So, I mean, it's easy to them because they have relatives living abroad in Europe. And but for locals, the prices are just unaffordable.
When you mentioned beforehand, I mean, the title of your talk is How Would You Like to Die? It seemed to be a subjective question rather than actually suggesting that they were going to kill you at that moment, because she was effectively saying, we would like to die because this is part of, we would be reading the Quran. If we died, we'll be going up to heaven, presumably. So did you feel threatened in terms of actually going to be killed? And when you were released, was it a surprise, or was it, how did that happen, actually happen then?
I've been threatened with death, not by Miriam, but by the Sheikh today. I mean, when I spent 4 days with the woman, but then I was brought back to the prison. And the Sheikh, when I got back to the prison, he was sarcastic and he said, this is your 5-stars room, go back to your room. And that was a terrible place. So I spent other 2 days in the prison, and then he said, he came 2 days after and he said, I was going to release you, but now I will release only your colleagues because you are a spy. You wrote in your notebook not just the prayers, but also your personal notes, and you are writing a dossier, a report about us. So, and he said, what should I do now? I will maybe cut your hands off, or maybe I have to kill you. So after that, I thought that, I was thinking about other women hostages, and rationally, I thought that maybe they were not going to kill me because they don't kill women in general. But yeah, of course, I was very scared. So finally, I've been asked, how would you like to die also?
And when you were released, I mean, was it a surprise in the way you know?
Yes. So when we were released, I thought that they were going to kill us. We went in a car, and the man who was driving, he had weapons with him, a rifle and a gun. He was driving with a gun. And it was the worst part of the 11 days, the worst moment. But then, I've been lucky.
As a journalist, did you or your group undergo any sort of hostile environmental awareness training or similar training prior to your departure? And if so, were you able to draw on that during your captivity? And if not, did you just draw on prior knowledge of your captors or the nature of your captors to emotionally survive?
No. So my colleagues were war journalists, and I wasn't. And I didn't have a hostile environment training course. But I think the knowledge of Syria and the jihadism helped a lot in my case. But I suggest to do it.
You said that they normally kill men when they are prisoners. And what do they do with women then, when they take any woman? What do they do with them?
I was quite sure that they were not going to rape me, but you can never know 100%. So, and also I played a lot this part, saying, thank God, I am held by your group. When I was talking to the Sheikh, I thank God every day because I know your respect, that you respect women. So, and also when I was moved from the prison to the women apartment, the leader, the Sheikh, was checking if I had any things that suspicious things or weapons, and he touched me for the first time and he apologized. He said, I'm very sorry to touch you, but you are the second woman I'm touching after my wife. And I said, it's okay, I understand, but please tell your fighters, tell your guys to not to touch me ever. And he said, I swear. And this, I don't know, gave me a sort of reassurance. But I knew about other women hostages raped by Al-Qaeda groups, but I mean, in Afghanistan. So far in Iraq and Syria, I never heard about rape.
Who paid the actual rent? Was it the company or an insurance company that they, or the goods that they received?
So the Italian government or the Italian state position in kidnapping is quite well known and clear, is that they protect their citizens all over the world when they have these kind of bad adventures. I want to be honest and mean. I want to, because I know how the position of US came about paying ransom, and is a bit critical, I know, but I mean, the fact that the Italian government is quite transparent about it, I think is a good thing compared to other more hypocritical governments like France, or yes, France that say that they don't pay, and in fact they pay because the French and Spanish journalists in Syria have been released. So I think that I mean, even if in our case we don't know exactly what did they pay, I don't think that paying ransoms is a is a fact that increase the kidnapping of Italians in the world. Because when they kidnap you, when a group kidnap you, don't ask for your passport. They first arrest you, and then they check your passport. So this is what I think.
Yeah. Did you get the impression that the people that kidnapped you were used to kidnapping lots of people? They had prisoners already, and this was just...
Yeah, the sheikh, the leader of the group, was a well-trained fighter in Iraq, and he had definitely experience of running a prison or dealing with prisoners. The other shabab, the fighters, were quite young. Maybe they didn't have experiences before, so I could see the difference between an experienced one and a super very young other. One, sometimes they were friendly, giving us more food or water, and sometimes they found the tough one. So I can't say they had all the same. I think it was coming all from the same experience.
When you were in your apartment, did you ever think of trying to escape, or was just that?
Actually, escaping is a sort of obsession when you are hostage. And I thought that escaping in that case was a suicide, because we were in an abandoned village surrounded by them, and there were 30 or 50 fighters. So I thought that was completely dangerous and impossible. But I have this image of me thinking of escaping in a terrible night during a storm, in which the noise of storm and the shelling was confusing. And I thought this is the perfect night to escape, because the shelling was very, very tough. And I convinced Miriam not to close the door with the key, because I said, if we have to escape, you can't close the door with the key. And she was terrified that night, because the shelling were particularly close. And I tried to sleep, but I didn't, with the door open. So I thought this is the perfect moment to escape, but I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
intensity.
Okay,
yeah.
Literally 1 minute,
I'll let you
ask your question.
Okay, you just said that you didn't hear anything about any stories about kidnapping women, raping women in Syria and Iraq. Do you think the media is giving us a wrong picture about what's happening in Syria and Iraq? Because every day we hear raping women, Assyrian women, Yazidian women, Christian women.
Yeah, I was talking about foreign hostages. So, of course, I can't know if they rape Syrian local hostages, but I was talking about foreign journalists kidnapped, and
Okay, thank you very much for that. To answer your question, I mean, rape is very much, has been going on for quite a while there, on all sides, by the way. Particularly by the Shabiha originally, who are extremely violent. Just anecdotally, Syrian FSA fighter, the leader who ended up cutting the heart out of a Shabiha, the Shabiha person went into that village and raped and killed 10 of his relatives, and this is the backstory to that, wasn't that it's part of FSA policy, Free Syrian Army policy, to go and do what he did, but he was so enraged by what this person did, you lose your mind when you see that happen to your relatives. So unfortunately, as in all war zones, rape is commonplace. I'd like to thank Susan for that extremely insightful talk. One doesn't get many opportunities to meet somebody and listen to their story, particularly somebody who has been in a highly stressful environment such as a kidnapping. We see the stories now, obviously, of what ISIS is doing in other war zones. Kidnapping and trading people for economic reasons is again commonplace. I thought your personal insights into the way that that Jabhat al-Nusra were thinking, particularly Miriam, was extremely insightful. I thought some of your feedback on their ideology was also very interesting as well. I'll give one more anecdotal story if I can do. When I was out there last August, and I met some people from the Farouk Brigade, and I said to them, and a couple of them had been in Jabhat al-Nusra and had come back. And I said to them, why did you go and why did you come back? And they said, well, when our village was being attacked, we went to the FSA to try and see if we can get weapons and support. And they said, sorry, we have nothing left. You know, we can't give you anything. So they went to Jabhat al-Nusra and said, can we join you? And they said yes, on condition of three things. One, you grow a beard, because some of them didn't have beards. Number two, you pray to Allah 5 times a day. And number three, that while you're with us, you don't go back to your family. And so they thought that was fine. They said, after one, they could, all three conditions seemed reasonable, but after 2 or 3 months, they said, we could do one and two, but we were missing our families. And so they went back to the other side. So even last August when I was there, things were fairly fluid between Free Syria Army and Jabhat al-Nusra. But ultimately, the weaker parties have folded, which is Jabhat al-Nusra has morphed into IS, and really Free Syria Army has gotten fairly weak, notwithstanding the recent support from the West. Anyway, thank you very much, Susan, for your insight, and good luck. Thank you.
Thank you.